Welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Alice Sampson, Assistant Professor with Nalsa University of Law. This paper is African and Caribbean Literatures. Today we are going to look at the module on V.S. Naipaul's A House for Mr. Biswas. Before beginning, let me give you a brief summary of the module. We will be looking at a background to the novel A House for Mr. Biswas, the life and works of Sir V.S. Naipaul, and look at some of the main themes and characters in this novel. Introduction to A House for Mr. Biswas. Listed among the 100 best novels written in English language in the 20th century, V.S. Naipaul's A House for Mr. Biswas is one of the most significant novels to have been written by a Caribbean author. The novel describes the travails of the protagonist, Mohan Biswas, who seeks to own a house in Trinidad. The novel is set in the first half of the 20th century. Even as the novel depicts the desires and insecurities of Mohan, it rather humorously depicts the lives of the various members of the gregarious Tulsi household. The novel provides a commentary on the relations between the different sexes in Indo-Trinidadian society, and it also throws light on the complexities of race and of impending exit of the colonial rule in the island. A House for Mr. Biswas was published in 1961 and it won V.S. Naipaul immediate international recognition. Naipaul based his novel on the life of his father, Sipersand Naipaul. Sipersand Naipaul, a son of indentured Indians, was a self-taught writer. At a very young age, Sipersand, an emancipated yet ambitious young man, was married into the influential Kapildeo or Kapildev family. The novel is set in the first half of the 20th century and all the main characters in the book are Trinidadians of Indian origin. A House for Mr. Biswas portrays the dynamic of the Indo-Trinidian community. It throws light on the superstitions, the culture of the emaciated descendants of Indian origin on the island. The descriptions of the lifestyles of the Ajoda and the Tulsi family is a record of this in detail. The action in the novel is situated in the first half of the 20th century, a period which witnessed massive political changes across the world. It discusses the genealogy of the coolie, the indentured laborer from various parts of South Asia to Trinidad. It portrays the prejudices and the malice prevalent in the Indian community residing in Trinidad. It depicts the troubles that the community faces to keep its religious, that is Hindu and caste identities intact. The novel demonstrates that the Indian community in Trinidad, despite contestations and cultivating hybrid and hyphenated identities. Module 2, Life and Background of Lord Vidyadhar Suraj Prasad. Lord Vidyadhar Suraj Prasad, a descendant of indentured migrant workers from India, Naipaul was born in Trinidad in 1932. Naipaul today is perhaps the most celebrated and the most widely read Caribbean prose writer author who writes in English. Born to Dropatic and Sipersand Naipaul, who was a self-taught journalist and a published creative writer, Naipaul drew in the multicultural milieu of rural Trinidad. Naipaul is also a prolific author of non-fiction. Since the 1960s, Naipaul has emerged as a powerful political and cultural critic. He quoted several serious controversies. He is known for his strong and often objectionable remarks on various subjects including India and Islam. However, Naipaul is celebrated for his unique literary style and for the range of subjects that his writings deals with. His prominent works of non-fiction include The Middle Passage, published in 1962, An Area of Darkness, 1964, India, A Wounded Civilization, published in 1977, Among the Believers, An Islamic Journey, 1981, A Turn in the South, 1989, India, A Million Mutinies Now, 1990, Beyond Belief, Islamic Excursion Among the Converted People, 1998, and The Mask of Africa in 2010. In 2001, Naipaul was awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature, having united perspective narrative and incorruptible scrutiny in works that compel us to see the presence of suppressed histories. Naipaul also has two published writers in his family. They include his father, Sipersand Naipaul, and his brother, Shiva Naipaul. Let's now look at some of the main works and themes in Naipaul's works. Naipaul wrote extensively on various themes. His works are set in India, Africa, Caribbean islands, and England. His subjects included Indians, people of Indian, African, and Caribbean origin, the white-skinned colonialists, the decolonized subjects from the Third World who now constitute the diaspora. Naipaul's fiction largely deals with the longing for home. The lead characters are self-driven, ambitious, and are worthy of their education. Their quest drives them towards displacement and exile. Towards the end of the novels, their quest notwithstanding, Naipaul's lead characters are defeated by the socio-political milieu. For instance, a bend in the river which begins with the sentence, "The world is what it is, men who are nothing, who allow themselves to become nothing, have no place in it," deals with the travails of Salim, a progeny of immigrants from South Asia to Africa, who was forced to relocate from the east coast of Africa to its hinterlands. Salim works hard and manages to prosper through a shop when the change in the political structure and the subsequent decolonization ruins his business. He is forced to abandon his shop and seek refuge overseas. He is thus coerced to migrate twice in his life. A House for Mr. Biswas portrayed the protagonist's own longing for a house. Mimic Men describes the personal and political travails of businessman politician Ralph Singh, who returns to the Caribbean island after completing his education in England. Ralph dabbles in the island's politics and is exiled by his former friends. Deeply hurt, Ralph returns to England. Willie Somerset Chandra is perhaps the most displaced among Naipaul's protagonists. The lead character in the novel, Half a Life, and its sequel, The Magic Seeds, Chandran migrates from India to London and then to Africa. The political uncertainty in the African nation forces him to shift to Berlin. Chandran is disappointed with life in Berlin, and his sister arranges for him to shift to India and fight alongside the communists. Chandran does not share the enthusiasm of his comrades. However, left with no option, he participates in the movement. He is arrested by the Indian state and on his return, settles down in England. Naipaul is often criticized for painting a grim picture of post-colonial subjects and societies. He depicts the post-colonies as lawless, as crumbling societies which are ruled by inept and corrupt megalomaniacs. He's often also accused of essentializing various communities. His writing is complex and his political views are contentious and contradictory. Many Indians found Naipaul's views expressed in the Indian trilogy, An Area of Darkness, India, Wounded Civilization, India, A Million Mutinies Now, rather intolerable. In India, A Wounded Civilization, Naipaul stated that the calamitous effect of Islam on its subjects' people was much worse than colonialism. He further stated that Islam destroyed India before declaring that there is this ill-informed idea that it was the British in the short time that they were there that ruined and defaced all those temples you see. The bitter fact is that the people of India were ill-equipped to face the organized military power of Islam and were destroyed by it. The intellectual life of India, the Sanskrit culture, stops at 1000 AD. Islam was the greatest calamity that befell it. Now people think only the Muslims built anything, but what they bought was a slave culture that lasted in some parts of India until almost the other day. In Among the Believers and Beyond Belief, Naipaul stated that to be a Muslim, you have to destroy your history, to stamp on your ancestral civilization. The sands of Arabia is all that matters. The abolition of the self is worse than the colonial abolition, much worse. Naipaul's writing indirectly helped the rise of Islamophobia and xenophobia in the world. Various reactionary forces at various times have also appropriated his writing. Let's now look at a summary of this novel, A House for Mr. Biswas. Bipti and Raghu Biswas are second generation descendants of indentured laborers of Indian origin residing in Trinidad. With Raghu's death, the family disintegrates. Pratap and Prasad are sent to stay with relatives from their paternal side, while Bipti, Dehuti and Mohan reside with Tara. Tara is Bipti's sister. She is married to Ajoda and the couple are childless. The couple is rich and own many commercial enterprises. Mohan is sent to school, while Dehuti is assigned domestic chores. Unable to stay with the Ajodas, Dehuti elopes with Ramachand, a low-caste domestic help. Mohan is pulled out of school and is sent to apprentice with Jairam, a Hindu priest. Mohan is unsuccessful and comes back to stay with the Ajoda family. At the Ajoda's house, Mohan cultivates a love for books. He reads extensively. He is sent to stay with Bandat, a younger brother of Ajoda, and assists him in the liquor business. Bandat, a lecherous, womanizing spendthrift who is constantly cheating Ajodas and the customers, distrusts Mohan. He manhandles Mohan and forces him to leave the shop. Mohan then decides to look after himself. He seeks out his school friend Ali and begins to paint signboards. An assignment takes him to Tulsi's shop. He sees Shama at the shop and instinctively writes her a love letter. The letter lands him in trouble as the Tulsis interpret it as a proposal for marriage. The wedding is quickly arranged and performed at the Tulsi's residence, the Hanuman house. Mohan and Shama are asked to stay in one of the many rooms in the... Mrs. Tulsi and her brother-in-law Seth want Mohan to work in their shop. Mohan is not prepared for a married life and finds the environment in the Hanuman house stifling. He yearns for independence and constantly finds means to express himself. Very early into his marriage, he realizes that the Tulsi household does not provide any reasonable means to live an independent and contented life. The marriage produces 4 children. Mohan heartily dislikes the gargantuan Tulsi household, which he finds regressive. He rebels at every opportunity. He tries to ascertain his independence on every occasion and wants to break away from the Tulsis. He detests every member in the household. He names Mrs. Tulsi the old queen and the old hen. He calls Seth the big boss and the big bull. He dislikes the high-handedness of his brothers-in-law Owad and Shekhar, whom he mockingly calls gods. He is repelled at the sight of Hari, the son-in-law, who serves as the spiritual leader of the household. Hari's obsession with his illness, his food practices, religious books irritate Mohan. He distrusts Padma, who is the wife of Seth. Mohan tries to seek the company of the rustic and illiterate Govind. Govind betrays Mohan's trust as he reports Mohan's complaints to Seth. Residents at the Hanuman house brand Mohan a troublemaker. He is often humiliated and is isolated. On one occasion, Govind manhandles Mohan. For Mohan, the Tulsis come to signify a decadent old order which is crumbling and has no place in the contemporary world which is constantly making and remaking itself. He deems himself trapped by circumstances and wants to escape from the situation. He reclaims his agency and lives life on his own terms. The Tulsis finally give way and allow Mohan to run a shop on one of their properties. For the first time in their marriage, Mohan and Shama live an independent life from the Tulsis. Mohan becomes a shopkeeper and his family resides in a house located behind the shop. Initially, Mohan is successful at managing the shop. However, at Shama's insistence, Mohan gets the shop blessed. He then gets into trouble and is in a legal case. Mohan loves the shop, loses the shop, and the family is forced to return to the Hanuman house. He, however, doesn't live at the Hanuman house for long. He rebels and is employed as a driver and an overseer on the family's plantation estate. Mohan's family is forced to live alongside 10 other families in the barracks. He resents the housing arrangement and the nature of his job. He is inept as an overseer and he tries to build his own house on the plantation. However, due to financial constraints, he is forced to compromise on the quality of the raw material and ends up procuring a weak house. The frail house is destroyed during a storm and Mohan is devastated. He is now forced to return to the Tulsi household again. He is emotionally estranged from them and moves to live with his sister in Port of Spain, beginning to seek employment in the city. Luckily, soon enough, he lands a job as a journalist with the Sentinel. As a journalist, Mohan is sensational and is not very efficient at his job. He relocates his family to Port of Spain. He begins to enjoy his independence in the new job. He aspires to become a writer, buys a typewriter and types a few sentences. Mrs. Tulsi intervenes again and manipulates the situation. Mohan and Shama reside as tenants at the family house in Port of Spain. Mohan's new job wins him the friendship and respect of his brothers-in-law. Shekhar is married to Dorothy, a Presbyterian of Indian origin. Owad leaves for England to study medicine at Cambridge. Seth and Mrs. Tulsi begin to disagree on most things and Tulsi seems to be on the verge of breaking up. Mrs. Tulsi and her children, along with their families, move away from the Arvakas to set up a new house on a plantation at the Short Hill. Much to his irritation and discomfort, Mohan is also forced to relocate to the new house. He achieves professional success and begins to build his own house on the estate. An accident leads to the house being burnt down. As the tenants at the Tulsi house in Port of Spain vacate, Mohan begins to reside in the Port of Spain. As a community welfare officer, Mohan begins to enjoy his job. He focuses on the education of Anand, buys a car, and begins to seem to be finally at ease with life. However, as various members of the Tulsi also relocate to Port of Spain, Mohan finds the house inhospitable and finds the environment to be stifling. To add to the crowd, Obad returns from England. Though trained as a doctor, his Marxist views notwithstanding, Obad is regressive and prejudiced as any member of the Tulsi household. He is overbearing and fights with Anand. His arguments with Mohan lead to a massive argument between Mohan and Mrs. Tulsi. As the community welfare department is disbanded, Mohan goes back to being a journalist with the Sentinel. He is now a seasoned journalist. His daughter Shama and son Anand win scholarships and find their way to England. Mohan is clearly middle-aged and searches for a house of his own with more vigor. He finally finds a house, arranges a loan with the Ajodas and buys it. The house is not as perfect as it looked and its faults render it dysfunctional. He realizes that the previous owner has cheated him. Mohan suffers a series of heart attacks and is diagnosed with serious heart ailment. He is in debt and is disappointed that his son and he do not share a warm relationship. However, he finds solace in the fact that Savi has proved to be an intelligent and warm daughter. Mohan gradually retires from the Sentinel and the newspaper hires Savi instead. Mohan steadily reconciles to life and towards the end of his life, he begins to live a contented life. Finally, he succumbs to a heart attack at the end of the novel. Let's now look at some of the main themes in A House for Mr. Biswas. The first main theme is the explication of the idea of the house. Mohan's efforts towards owning a house is a metaphor of his quest at finding his space in the modern world. Mohan seems to be a complex character whose family deems him to be fickle-minded, adventurous, and a misguided man. He is alienated from his family members and seeks to find a place of his own. Naipaul has stated that the character of Mohan was inspired by his father's life. Siparsad Naipaul found himself choked amidst the Kapildeo family. Like Mohan, Siparsad was quite alienated with his surroundings and craved for a better life. He constantly sought opportunities to improve himself and to advance his goals. Naipaul remembers his relatives making fun of his father's efforts. Despite several humiliations and insults, Siparsad focused on making and remaking himself. His efforts paid off as he began to make his living as a journalist, became an author, owned a house, and educated his sons in England. In a relatively short span of 5 decades, Siparsad, who was born to emaciated, almost illiterate and indentured labor, accomplished many of the objectives that he set out for himself. Mohan's quest at owning a house emerges as a very significant marker. Even as the Tulsis laugh at his attempts to own a house and live an independent life, Mohan carries on with his quest. He tries to build or buy a house in several locations. Every time, fate intervenes and his efforts are nullified. The quest seems to be a doomed affair, notwithstanding the small awards that come his way. Even as he seeks to own his own house, Mohan buys a bicycle and graduates to driving a motor car. He is employed in office spaces which are meant for learned men, where he can wear suits to work. His children win scholarships to study abroad. He finally buys and moves into a two-storied house, which he realizes is full of defects. Yet, very unlike him, Mohan is reconciled to its defects. Mohan yearns for space and dignity and recognition, which he seeks in a house of his own. Space, dignity and individual recognition are a testimony of a person's agency in modern society. Mohan is the only true modern individual in the novel. He has comprehended that the old colonial order is being replaced by a new chaotic milieu and is aware that the new world brings in opportunities. Ironically, many members of the Tulsi household who initially mock Mohan gradually copy him and strive for better jobs and education for their children. Another important theme in the novel is the breakdown of conventional societal structures. A House for Mr. Biswas depicts the breakdown of societal structures among the Indian community in Trinidad. Since the 19th century, people of Indian origin who stayed in the islands as indentured labor strove hard to keep their identities intact. Though severely emaciated and poor, These laborers wanted to retain the caste hierarchies on the island. They practiced religious and caste rituals and often created new rituals to mark themselves as culturally distinct from the other communities. These religious and cultural practices provided the Indian community with a sense of identity. The Indian community often looked up to the family structure to uphold its sense of community. The family was expected to teach its children the cultural rituals, which in turn made the children a part of the Indian community. However, within a span of a century, these bonds became weak, notwithstanding the periodic visits to India and the regular visits of religious leaders from South Asia to the island. The Hindu community in Trinidad faces a severe identity crisis. The crisis occurred due to several reasons, including the rise of nationalism in the islands, the weakening of the colonial structure, the change in the political economy of the island, and the migration of young people to England. Naipaul points out that the indentured labor could work on the plantation. The plantation offered work on a large section to a large section of the population, but in the 20th century, as the plantations gave way to service industry, an individual had to be clever to get work. The struggle against the colonial rule and the demand of self-rule brought together the black and the Asian populations. Let's examine some of the main characters in A House for Mr. Biswas. The first main character is Mohan Biswas. He is an ambitious, progressive, and diligent son of indentured poor parents. Mohan is self-taught and is self-driven. He becomes a respected official and a journalist in Trinidad. For most part of the novel, he is seen as an anomaly. However, by the end of the novel, all the characters begin to follow him and seek to advance themselves in a manner similar to his. Often he takes more responsibility than he can handle, and thereby most of the tasks that he has initiated are either left incomplete or are performed haphazardly. The other main character is Shama. Shama is a long-suffering wife of Mohan. She is torn between the old order, that is of her family, and her husband. She is religious, skeptical, and conservative, and seeks to maintain the status quo. She handles every trouble that Mohan brings in. By the middle of the novel, she stops protesting against Mohan's outlook, but silently seeks to restore order into the family's life. Mohan, towards the end of his life, acknowledges that Shama is a better judge of circumstances. She is an excellent mother, and it is due to her initiatives that her children are housed and fed at the Tulsi household. Mrs. Tulsi is the matriarch of the Hanuman house and has an iron grip over the lives of her children. Mohan derogatorily calls her the old queen and the old hen. She uses both financial and emotional modes, which ensures that her daughters and their families stay within her control. She relies heavily on Seth, but towards the second half of the novel falls out with him. She disapproves of any changes in her household. She is a conservative Hindu woman who does not educate her daughters and marries them off as young brides to almost illiterate men. However, she takes great interest in the education of her sons. Her control over the household diminishes as the novel progresses. Seth is the other main character. He is termed the big bull by Mohan. After the death of Pandit Tulsi, Seth emerges as the patriarch of the Tulsi household. Bound to the Tulsis by marriage, Seth is a burly, unethical businessman who handles the business affairs of the Tulsis. After the death of his wife, the Tulsis distance themselves from him and he suffers serious business losses. Even his nephews do not reconcile with him. Another character in the novel is Owad, a favorite of the Tulsi household. Owad is the youngest son of Mrs. Tulsi. He leaves for England to pursue higher studies and only returns towards the later half of the novel. He is unable to accommodate cultural values that he was taught in Trinidad with the modernity that he has been exposed to in England. For the progressive discourse that he dispenses, Owad is actually very intolerant and bossy. His strong views that Indians from the subcontinent do not adhere to caste dharma and his high-handed behavior towards Anand are indicative of the fact that his education in England has not really changed him. Towards the end of the novel, Owad, like his elder brother, marries a Presbyterian and moves away from the Tulsi household. Savi is the eldest child of Mohan. She grows up in the Tulsi household and despises her father. Mohan tries his best to win her over to his side and gives her a toy house. Though Mohan does not display much interest in her education, Savi wins a scholarship to study in England. She returns as a strong, independent and capable journalist who loves her father and financially supports him during his last days. Anand is a child very attached to his father Mohan. Mohan invests time, energy, money and hope into Anand's education. Anand is diligent, sensitive and a very studious boy. He wins the scholarship and goes to England. However, the emotional bond between the father and the son snaps and Anand seldom writes back to his father. The Ajodas are a wealthy and childless Ajoda couple, are the extended family of Mohan. They are Mohan's guardians. They have a soft corner for the diligent and young man. Despite their calculative behavior, the Ajodas financially aid Mohan as and when he asks them. They are meritocratic and less prone to be influenced by family and caste ties. To sum up, we have examined in detail V.S. Naipaul's A House for Mr. Biswas. We have looked at Naipaul's own background, the influence that his father, Sipersan Naipaul, had on the character of Mohan Biswas. We have examined the plot of the novel and some of the major themes and characters in this novel. For more information, look at the e-text. Thank you.